The 1971 Star Trek game did what no other Star Trek game ever could. Be a game worth talking about. Now let's head back to the year it was created to discuss that fancy Star Trek TV show that had just done 3 seasons before suddenly being cancelled because Captain Kirk ran out of hot aliens to smash. Try being a nerd then, what's your fallback, right? They didn't have 1,000 shows to distract them from the shit show of Game of Thrones like we do now. All they had were gigantic mainframe computers in the universities and plenty of free love. That was the case for Mike Mayfield at least. He was finally a high schooler who had, in his words, managed to use, read, steal an account on a Sigma 7 at University of California. Any budding developer who has to subterfuge their way into cutting-edge tech is cool by me, and he did it on a Sears motorcycle too, like some sort of 70s John Connor. This wasn't a PC, I remind you. This was a fucking big boy mainframe that could do so much sweet fuck all. These days when we think of making games compatible for things, it generally means making it mobile friendly or removing most of the polygons so it can run on a Nintendo Switch. But for Mike it meant coming up with a game that you could also play off a printer because screens weren't even a given. What he was working on was Star Trek, and I think you could possibly argue a roguelike, a decade before Rogue even came out. It features a randomly generated galaxy map which is navigated turn by turn in ASCII. It is permadeath and even resource management. Personally, I'm glad we don't need to call games Star Trek-likes. Gameplay features the Enterprise scanning and hopping around, hunting down Klingons and killing them all before the time runs out, and if the time does run out, it fucking abuses you. it just prints out like, go fuck yourself. Due to the memory and save restrictions, Mike kept the game tight, but making the game procedural at the same time gave it solid replay value if you ever wanted to burn through reams of paper. How many goddamn trees were lost playing this game? Imagine a time when your refresh rate was based on how fast your printer was, like one frame per 30 seconds. Through a series of boring events I cannot be bothered getting into, he came into contact with HP, who asked if he would like to work on a version of this game on their own HP 2000 Sears. The original version he was working on got ditched like a bag of kittens into a river, and the HP version is the one we have record of today. HP then published it in their public domain software catalog, which is a physical book of programs, and from there people republished it in newsletters, and then eventually in a book called 101 Basic Computer Games. The book sold more copies than there were computers to write them on. There was no copy-pasting either. If you wanted to play a game, you had to write it all out yourself, onto whatever machine you could get your hands on. I don't see Ubisoft brave enough to print me out an entire code dump of Assassin's Creed and deliver it to me on pallets. You know what? Gamers now are just little slugs living on one of those Matrix battery cells, tapping the dopamine button on Steam to instantly give them a game. Not like me though, I fucking hate myself. I'm still typing out the code for Morrowind I got on release day. Now, here's where the magic happens, right? When you're writing out an entire game, you're gonna tweak it. People added new systems and the game became a Chinese whisper of a program, morphing over time. Some had to take even greater leaps because there were so many different PC ecosystems that they had to do entire ports. Every message board I've found on the subject have old dogs listing the rigs that they played it on and commenting on just how ubiquitous it was, like PC syphilis. This little game fragged PC gaming to such a degree that we'll never really be able to measure just how much of an impact it had. The sheer number of different versions this game has is mind-boggling, and most of them never left their owners' PCs. The task of finding out how many ports, clones, and spin-offs it's had is just a massive task that would require actual effort that I'm just not willing to put in. I did start to make a timeline myself, but it quickly turned into one of those paranoia murder walls. Because it was never distributed under the same name or publisher, it'll never swagger around like Elite saying it's one of the oldest franchises, or like Tetris saying it's the most ported. Elite actually got inspiration for their galaxy generation from Star Raiders, which in turn had been inspired by Star Trek. And you know what? After all that, I'm not even sure Mayfield got paid. Personally, I came in first contact with this game as a kid via Visual Star Trek, which was on a floppy disk I literally found in someone's trash. I'm a rat, okay? Don't shame the customs of my people. The game looks like a Petri dish simulator, but it's actually a lot of fun. Apparently nobody even knows who made this game. Like so many of its peers, it just seemed to spring out of the ground like my children out of a burst sewer main. Hey man, you had to laugh at something, it might as well be your own joke. The last port I know of is an entirely web-based version just published a couple months ago. The kids of the 70s needed no encouragement making video games, but how many budding programmers started their careers copying this game out and just saying, this game would be a lot better if I was not a virgin. That's not the line I'm supposed to use. In some ways, it's the bones of a game that inspires you to add more. It imbues you with the hacker spirit. The same one that gets modders to add more fluff to Minecraft, or promotes child slavery to create Roblox games. Doing a Game of the Year award for anything predating the 70s is like holding a Miss Universe contest for amoebas in the primordial soup. So I'm drawing the line at 1971. That would make this game the first chronological winner of the Golden Ratty Award. Your impact may never truly be measured, Star Trek, my love. But in my heart, your game, it just helped pave the way for all the rest. And you're never going to be appreciated for it. But I appreciate you. Good game. Good game. Pat, pat.
Now, the ASMR whisper.
Golden Ratty Award.
That'll get the Patreons swarming up.